You're listening to Deja.
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 Welcome to another episode of the Open Mat Show. I'm your host, Mike T. Got Miss Lopez with me.
Welcome back.
Danny B with me. Special guest in the building, Darren Ammo Hamilton. Welcome, brother. Welcome, welcome.
Yeah.
See, you're sporting a new tattoo?
Yeah, not really sporting it. It's hot in here, man. It's hot.
For those of you that don't know, this guy is the former super lightweight champion, right?
Yeah, of Great Britain.
Of Great Britain.
Yeah.
What are you up to now? You still fighting? What's good? What's good in your world?
Do you know what? I had a fight, I think it was about a month ago in my hometown.
Yeah.
Bristol.
Okay.
Yeah, it was an awkward guy. I won.
Yeah.
Beat him on points. From that point then, it was kind of like a bit difficult for the financial situation or the money that I was expecting to get. Wasn't what I expected. So I kind of like took a bit of a back step to kind of like, I'm in college at the moment, retaking my level 3 personal trainer.
Okay, nice.
But I'm still training and waiting for an opportunity to come up. So
yeah.
That's where I'm at the moment.
Good.
So you're originally from Bristol.
From Bristol, yeah.
What was it like growing up in Bristol? What was your childhood like?
Okay. Do you know when anyone from London asks me that? It's like the first thing you've got is a bubble around your head thinking that it's like is a farm with cows. There's no cows there. You have cars and a town and that. But do you know what? It was just, it's kind of like London, but a smaller London, you know, and we have same kind of issues that face, that you guys here face. And I was born in that sort of environment. And part of my remarkable story was that I was a good kid. I grew up rough. And that's what Bristol was like for me. I mean, obviously, you might see someone else tell you that there's fields and cows, but where I lived, there weren't no fields or cows. So we lived in the city, the rough part of the city. So I had a bit of a rough upbringing, which is part of.
I read one of your articles about your upbringing, and it said in there, I'm not saying it's true, that the reason you moved to London was because you got death threats.
Yeah.
And you didn't want to end up in a coffin before you were 30, which is a very sensible choice.
Yeah.
Is that true? Or is
someone
that...
just went in and worded it that I don't want to end up before 30. Why not be, you know, okay, cool. Yeah, kind of, you know, obviously, you know, death threats, you know, no one wants to die, really.
Of course not.
At the same time, I thought that I could do better as well. Do you know what I mean? The guys I was hanging around with, they wasn't a professional boxer. Can you believe I was still doing badness when I was a pro boxer? But what kept drawing me to the street, and it's something which people don't realize about the game, is that... you know, you speak to someone, you speak to especially females, you say to them, I'm a boxer, the first thing they think is, where's your Porsche?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it ain't like that. I mean, at the beginning, I think my first pro fight made about £1,400. I mean.
That's decent money, don't
it? If you have to train 3 months for it.
Yeah.
And I had a job, I was working in Asda before that. Do you know what I mean? I gave up my Asda job to turn pro. And I was like, I want to be pro. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I had the same illusion as everyone else has. Like, you're gonna make mad money. And then I had that. I was like, wow. And the first person to have a problem with it is your woman, your baby mum's. Do you know what I mean? Your baby mum's like, what? You only got £1,400 here?
Well, all that time you've been out jogging in the morning.
Yeah, you're in the ring in shorts getting thumped up in your face, yeah? For 1,000. Do you know what I'm like? You have to come over to that drama as well and you only got £1,400. That gone, because obviously, you know what I mean? You haven't got the residual income, and that was the beginning of me realising that boxing isn't really what it seems. And,
because obviously you've taken it to good heights.
Yeah.
In the British.
Yeah. Took it to a next level. Mm. And that was out of hunger and belief in myself. Because again, the way the game's set, the game's not set like this. So if you watch a fight, know that fight is not a 50-50 fight. Fights are always made so that the one person is meant to win. If you see Anthony Joshua in any kind of fight, he's in that fight because he's meant to win that fight. So that makes sense. And as much as you think it's 50-50 and anyone else, any big name that you could think of, if they're in a fight, they're in that fight, 50-50 fight. Do you know what I mean? It's just like they're put in that position to win.
Well, you're saying that's the way it is in
that's
boxing.
That's the way our boxing is
at
set.
All levels, a Floyd level, a Frotch level,
I would say,
a Kell Brook level.
I would say there is some instances of 50-50 fights.
Yeah.
And that's when everyone can get their back up and everyone can stay up late and watch the fight. But most of the time, even with the Floyd Mayweather fight, even the way the whole thing set, not going into too much detail, but the way the whole organisation set, referees,
design,
judges,
Las Vegas.
It's all set so someone can win. And I mean, I'm not trying to badmouth boxing. I just think that was the part of my remarkable story, because if they never set it like that, for me to be the underdog and me to come in and take the opportunity at 5 days' notice with a flu, then I would never have been able to have this remarkable story to tell to other people. Do you know what I mean? I would never be British champion now.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people are still, and there's a lot of people in the division that are good enough to be British champions. There's a lot of people that are better than the British champions. But because of the politics of it, they will always be fighting and fighting the eliminators and doing this and getting pushed back. And
when we say politics, are we like saying if you're signed to a particular guy?
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Come on. And a lot of it's down to ticket sales as well, which is basically it. Ticket sales and obviously the way he was managed. So obviously you come up the right way.
Yeah.
It's like me. I never had a good amateur background because I was doing what I was doing. So it makes sense. So the other kid that went to the Olympics had the opportunity to go to the Olympics, got a gold. He's all right. He's guaranteed to win his next 10 straight fights.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
It's been set up nice.
He's matched well. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Sense. And without going into too much detail, because there's a lot of factors that affect winning and losing in boxing. So you think maybe just because the judges might be on your side, not just that, there's other factors as well. But when you're brought up that way, you're put in that position to win. Does that make sense? And also, if you're profitable to them, so like there's a lot of massive ticket sellers.
Yeah.
In boxing. Do you know what I mean? Some ticket sellers sell 400 tickets, 500 tickets. And again, sorry, not bringing up the black thing. I might bring it up a couple of times now, but yeah. It's true. Being black and selling tickets is like, I can't think of an example, but being black and selling tickets is quite hard. So black guys don't really sell tickets. Do you know what I mean?
So it's going to be harder for them to break through into that system.
Yeah, it's going to be harder for you to break through in that system. A lot of the guys that sell tickets, maybe if you're the only Turkish or Albanian person and you go out, your whole community will come out and watch you. Do you know what I mean? Sense?
Yeah.
You'll be looked after then. Again, you'll get that same route. Maybe the next 10 fights, you'd win that straight. Mm. And then you'll get put in a position to be a champion. And then basically my positioning wasn't set up like that.
Yeah.
So I came in as the underdog. I came in at 5 days' notice and won it when no one thought I should have won it. I won it when the bookies said I should have won it. And a 22-1 underdog became British light waterweight champion.
So that fight you was entering, you was basically set up to lose, yeah, basically. That's what it was. Yeah.
So when you hear the term in boxing, when you hear the term opponent, it means that you're just there to be someone to walk through. There's a level though, because if I had like, all right, let's say if I had 40 fights, won 2, lost 38, then I'm not an opponent. You're not credible enough. You haven't got the credibility to become an opponent to fight for a British title.
Okay.
But because I had already won a Southern Area title, and I had 1 loss on my record. Sorry, 2 losses on my record.
Yeah.
Almost for disqualification. But I was at that level to say, yeah, bring him in. He's not gonna cause no problems. And 5 days' notice, you can't possibly prepare for a fight, for a 12-round fight. That's like fighting for like, is it 42 minutes in the ring? 42 minutes. You need to make a certain weight in boxing. You have to get down to a certain weight. You're not going to be able to be. So for first 4, 3 or 5 rounds, you're going to look good. And then the end of the fight, you're going to deteriorate. That's what they're hoping on. That's where you get bought in as an opponent, so you come and lose because the money is on the winner.
So you changed the odds and obviously won that fight.
I won that fight, yeah.
How was it after that? Did you was it easier for you to obtain an opponent, or would you say people were scared to possibly come out and fight you after that, or people just didn't want to promote you or sign you with the right person or right manager?
I had my manager who was with me from the beginning. He was the person who stood by me and said and brought out the belief in me. I said I can do this and defeat the odds.
Who is your manager?
Spencer Fearon.
Cool.
Yeah. Nice. Without going too much into the story, if you watch my autobiography on Facebook, it's kind of moving still. Every time I watch it, I kind of get moved.
What's it called? Tell the people.
Darren Hamilton autobiography. It's on Facebook.
I'll be going home to watch that tonight.
Yeah, yeah. It doesn't go too much into it, but I'm gonna go and tell people a bit more about what went on that night as well. But yeah, obviously, getting the call, obviously my manager's the first person to say to you, you're going to be fighting.
Yeah.
But I don't know if you know anything about Spencer Fearon. Spencer Fearon is like a very motivational guy, you get me? He's a motivational talker as well. And he can raise the spirit up in someone.
Okay.
So you imagine 5 days before you're going to fight for a British title on Sky Television. John, come on for him.
Yeah.
Your biggest fear in fighting is getting knocked out on TV in front of your people.
Yeah.
I'm like, wait a minute, what am I doing?
You're on Sky,
this
yeah.
This man made me believe that I was okay. I was dying with the flu. When I'm talking about flu, I'm talking about not like man flu. You know what I'm saying? Like a man got man flu. No, I'm talking about. Have you ever had the flu when your bones hurt and you're like, I'm dying? Like
literally every joint hurting.
Every day I had to take a bit more Beecham's and more. My cold was getting worse each day. And this is when I realised that Beechams don't work.
No, nah, suppressors.
Have that ginger and lemon.
Yeah. Suppressors.
Oh my god! This one, oh my god! High five over here. Give me a quick one. Ginger and lemon. How could I not know that? Listen, for anyone that wants to get rid of their cold or flu or any kind of symptoms, or raise your immune system, ginger and lemon. And I went to Spencer Fearon's nan's house. She gave me an old Jamaican remedy which had ginger in it and some next. I don't know what it was. Some vinegar or something. I said, "Yo, go drink that. Drink that."
And
licked it back. I was like,
ooh, hot and ting.
Hot, yeah. I went in the bed. I wrapped up. I sweated.
Sweated. Yeah.
And I woke up next day. I was like, kind of fine, but I was still overweight. So I still had to. So he kept getting me up out of the bed, putting me on the scales. Like, in my head, I was going to myself, "Wait a minute. I can't fight in tomorrow. I'm almost dead." No, sorry, yeah, I can't fight tomorrow because today was the weigh-in. Listen, you've got to make 10 stone. That was like 10.4.
Okay.
So you can imagine that was still a little bit over. Jeez. Hadn't eaten for like 3 days.
Yeah.
I was dying with the flu, and this man is making me believe. He kept saying to me, it's God's work. Oh, so I didn't mention one part, so I didn't want to go too much into it, but there was a stage where when I left Bristol and I wanted to get away from the badness, I became homeless and I started living in the gym, the same gym that I met you at.
That's what I was going to get to.
Yeah.
Okay.
When I first ever came to the gym where Darren was at, that's where you were living, right?
Yeah, I was living in the gym.
Yeah,
living in the gym, and I just believed that there was something better for me in London. I didn't know what it was,
but that's why, like I say, with myself, like, and I see from when I first got there, that's where you were living.
Yeah,
and then to see you win the British title,
yeah,
like that's an amazing accomplishment. Amazing.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah,
and Spencer McPherson took you under his wing, and you're like forever grateful for all the work that he did for you.
Yeah, and the belief that he had in me. Mm. I mean, and obviously, yeah. Then he made me believe that, I'm gonna overcome this. And certain things I can't say how I actually finally made the weight on that day, because obviously I'll get fined. He'll get fined.
Yeah.
But we actually made the weight, which I would never advise any other person to do what I did on that day. And I honestly believe, anytime you watch boxing, anything you see, any kind of remarkable achievement you see in boxing, I swear that you'd never see in this lifetime anything done what that was done on that night.
Wow.
I've never heard of it done. I mean, so anyway, but sort of back to the ginger thing. Yeah, ginger, guys. If anyone could think of a remedy, we could go at this and make it like a cold remedy and put ginger in this.
Garlic as well.
Garlic as well. Call it the day jar. Call it the day jar remedy. But anyway, yeah, but the ginger thing. But the neck, but obviously that day I was still a bit ill. I took and I said myself, wow, the ginger's working. So I kept, so obviously I made the weight, had more ginger, kept eating ginger. I started eating it raw. I was like, wow, it started giving me a kick. And I started feeling the effects from it. And by the next day, I went to sleep that night. By the next day, I felt completely renewed. And I had this feeling in me. I was like, it was a weird feeling. It's like I had the presence of something with me in me. Like, I don't know, I don't want to talk like I'm a nutcase. But when I woke up in the room, it felt like someone was behind me, or someone was uplifting me saying, you got this. I was like, wow, I'm going to win. I can win. And I started visualizing seeing the British title in front of me in the hotel room.
Mm.
I said, wow, I'm going to win this. I'm going to win this. And then, you know what I mean? And then I just locked my phone off. I didn't even realize that all of the people in my hometown in Bristol were betting on me. They all bet on me.
Wow.
And my nickname,
they know you,
they know me. They say, yeah, I'm a must win. You must win this. But they didn't know what I was going
to do. Yeah, you must win.
You must win. You must win. But they all bet. They know, you know, everyone betted on me. I didn't realize that I was a 22-1 underdog.
Wow.
And all now, them guys are still giving me no money, you know? Not even, I've seen them as like they avoid me, they avoid the question. Like, I was boxing. Like, well, you remember the time you bet me? Oh, yeah, I was boxing. And I completely avoid. But yeah, they must have made a nice change on me. 22-1 underdog. I mean, yeah, I'm happy to have been in that position, to have overcome that position.
Yeah. So you're still currently obviously active.
Yeah, I'm active. I mean, it's in my blood.
Yeah.
But I've took on the responsibility of being a trainer, because a lot of people look up to my training methods. I train extremely hard, really hard, very hard. And a lot of other pro fighters come up to me and go, come on, can you train me? And that keeps my hunger alive. So I go to the gym and I train with them, and I do all my weird methods and my weird running methods, because I've got some different running methods, which I'll never tell, obviously.
Yeah.
I don't want everyone to be doing it, but we do a lot of stuff, and I train pros, and I'm going for my professional license. To be a pro trainer.
That's really good.
My level 3, but you never know, the opportunity might come up.
Of course.
And I saw you say you wanted to train David Price.
Oh, I got a lot of stick for that. I'm telling you, I got a lot of stick for that. But yeah, but I said, listen, if I'm going to train someone, listen, you see trainers, yeah? A lot of trainers get a lot of they get held up a lot for training someone who's meant to be a champion. That doesn't show your attributes as a trainer.
Yeah.
I mean, I want to train someone with a losing record. I want to train someone who's lost 3 on the trot. I want to train someone who just got knocked out.
I'm going to turn them around.
Yeah, and turn them around.
Yeah.
I want to train someone who got fitness problems. Do you know what I'm saying? and in an event. I don't even want no money out of it. Because I know one day, man is going to recognise that I've got the method. Do you know where I'm coming from?
Yeah.
I know I've got the method. Because if I could take fights, that wasn't the only fight I took on short notice. Yeah? I took more fights on short notice. So I must be doing something different than everyone else is doing. My training methods are different. And the reason why I know my training methods are different because I've been to loads of gyms and I've seen how fighters train. You don't train hard enough.
Yeah.
Do you know where I'm coming from? So that's, you know, but yeah, eventually, I'll be not even a British champion, but a world champion trainer one day. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
It's good ambitions, man.
Yeah, of course.
You got that believe, achieve, receive.
I like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to teach that. It's mine.
Let's talk about your loss to Curtis Woodhouse.
Yeah.
I watched it again, I think about 2 days ago. Do you feel that he did enough to take the title?
Do you know what? I think he did enough to take the title in Hull with a story. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
He did enough to take the title with a story in Hull. Yep. Had it been that same fight, no story, even with the story, mm-hmm. same fight, same story, and it would have been in, I don't know, Olympic Park.
It was always going to happen.
Yeah, I wouldn't even have won it on a split decision. I would have just won it. Mm-hmm. Maybe would have won it by two or three rounds.
Yeah, McGuigan said you did enough for him.
Yeah, yeah, and if you look at it, not drawn into the story, if you look at it, how you should look at a fight, you'd see that I clearly won. And I mean, I've always said it as well. And I still say it when this is all done and we're at a boxing dinner and Curtis is old and I'm sat next to him, I go, you know he didn't win that, right? You know he didn't win that. Bullshit. But that's boxing for you, do you know what I mean? And obviously, if you see what Adam Booth is a dark lord, they call him a dark lord. That man had a game plan. They said, listen, at the end of the day, you're not going to throw more punches than this guy.
Yeah.
You're not going to hit him more times than you're going to hit him. So what you need to do is just hustle for the first 2 minutes, plod along, which they did do. And at the last minute of the round, yeah, at the last minute of the round, just throw a whole heap of punches and win the last part of the minute of the round.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And then you've got your whole heap of whole fans screaming and bawling.
So it looks like he's the more active guy towards the end of the round. Yeah. Exactly.
And, a lot of shots to the body. I mean, I left that fight, sustaining the least amount of punishment I've sustained in any of a fight. You would be better off saying, actually, Fear Fame won rather than Curtis beat me. Does that make sense? I would have thought the fight was closer between me and actually Fear Fame. Does that make sense? And by that time, I've mastered the style of catching shots and throwing back shots. So I know I'm tagging you more times than you're tagging me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm not that guy. I know how to win a round.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm coming from? So when you're trying to have a little burst at the end of the round, I'm thinking, but I've already tagged you about 40 times already. If you're doing it. So them little five times, do you know what I mean? So that's how the judges is
perceiving it
and scoring it. So obviously either they scored it on emotion or they scored it on just a hustle.
Yeah, one or the other. Yeah. So after that fight, so you lose on decision, do you go back to your change room? Are you vexed? Because in your mind, you know, really, like, I'm sure I did enough. Are you anxious? Do you know what? I need to see that tape. Like, I need to re-watch it.
I mean...
Or did you just know, I won? Like,
yeah, I mean, I said to myself, I knew I won. Yeah. But at the same time, I wanted to know what the setup was.
Because
I would have never... If I would have went to Hull... Knowing that the setup was that he was going to get an advantage on points, maybe I would have stepped up a little bit more.
Okay.
Maybe that might have maybe put me in a bit more of my comfort zone because that was that day there I signed this guy. Do you know what I mean? And that was the day I signed this guy, and it was a Sky show. So I didn't care that it was in her. So I thought, okay, cool. It goes to the cards. I'm going to get the decision. Do you know that makes sense?
Yeah, of course.
But I wouldn't have expected to get the decision if I thought I lost though. I'm a man that goes, you know what, I think I lost that.
Yeah.
I still had the title. I said, look, I think I lost that. But
I've got the belt. Yeah.
I'm just like that. But I come out that ring and thought, wow, what's happening? Nah, them man there. And I thought, I've been punked. You know what I mean? Yeah, I've been punked. Yeah, you know the one there? Yeah. You know the ones? Like back in the day, there's certain kind of exchanges happen, and just when the exchange happens, you realize, rah, I've just been punked. Like, when I left the ring, I was like, rah, like, I just got punked. Because at the end of the day, I signed to them, man. Their man said, okay, cool, we've got a bright future for you. We're thinking about you and Willie Lemon next and whatnot. Close fight on your Sky show on Sky TV in Hull, and you make me lose a split decision. And I look back on it, and it's not good. Looking back on fights, if you're a fighter,
yeah,
looking back, you don't want to watch a fight. Like, no, I don't want to watch it. And Spencer forced me to watch the fight. I was like, I didn't lose that. I didn't lose it. Commentator didn't think I lost. I didn't think I lost.
So does that take your hunger away? Like the next morning you wake up, you're like, do you know what? Like,
it deflated me.
Yeah.
It deflated me. And the woman I was with at the time, she kind of helped me. You know what I mean? She boosted me back up and gave me that. And I said, yeah, I want to fight for it again. And I got the hunger back again.
Yeah.
And finding momentum again after that.
Must be difficult.
It was difficult. But at the same time, it should have been easy to get a fight. And this was what made me realize that people, even after that fight, still realize I won the fight because I was still was feared. Do you know what I'm saying? Because I was still trying to make fights with Tyrone. So I was still trying to make fights with other names coming up.
Yeah.
And Curtis Woodhouse said he wouldn't fight me again. He'd rather fight Willie Limmered. No one wanted to fight me. I was like, what? Then I started realizing that everyone in my weight division, when they have interviews, they make interview and they go, yeah, our potential fights. Now, you remember now, my name is like number one, number two, number three. It keeps changing, yeah?
Yeah.
In the BoxRec. So BoxRec, you've got different kind of rankings. So when they say, oh, if you say to a man, oh, who do you want to fight? Me, potentially, I'd say number one, number two, number three, number four. I'd just go down the list.
Yeah.
They'd always go down the list and miss my name. Like, my name ain't like, they can't say my name. Like, my name is a
excellent. Why, though? What, are they told not to? Or is it literally that your skill set is dangerous to them, that they don't want
to
touch it?
They don't want
quickest route to the belt they want.
The quickest route to the belt. Do you know what I mean? They don't want to mess about with someone who, like, this guy, we don't understand him. Because obviously there's one stage they underestimated me, and everyone's like, oh, we could beat him, I could beat him.
Yeah.
Kept winning. I beat the last boogeyman, because they called the person who was the X-Man, the man who no one wants to fight, the boogeyman. And the last person who was the boogeyman who I fought on my second title defense of the title was Adil Amor. That was the man that no one could beat.
Yeah.
And then I beat him, and I like him, but I'll have to be honest, no disrespect to him, but I ended his career. After that, he's never been the same again.
Yeah.
And man is looking at there thinking to himself, wow, what the hell is this guy working with? Do you know what I'm What is he working with? My name don't get mentioned anymore. The other guy who I beat, who I got disqualified for headbutting, sorry for saying it, but it happened. But I
don't know. Deliberately?
Huh?
Deliberately? Headbutting?
How old was it? That was your first fight, wasn't it?
No, it was my first fight. It was one of my it was my first fight after my win of the Southern Area title, and I thought it was a bit of a grudge match. We got into words like, if you ever see any of my fights, I kind of get in people's head. We rap about them, chat about me, and then it got. I thought that he headbutted me. He tried to headbutt me, but I put my head down and I caught him. His head cut his eye, and after that, I thought, oh, I'll catch you again. Even though I caught you again, and I tried to catch him. I'm not good at cheating, so I tried to headbutt
That's
him.
A good
and
thing.
I mistimed him. I mistimed him. Headbutt. He went, woo! I went, no, give me a chance. Six, qualified.
Done.
But I had a rematch with him. I even said to him, I was that confident. In that couple, that was the first round I got disqualified. I was that confident that I'd beat him. But I said, next fight, I will pay you my whole purse. But you have to pay for my fees. That's my training fees and my training and all that.
Yeah.
So I didn't get paid for the next fight. So I paid him my purse just to fight me again. And he came back down to London, York Hall, and I beat him. I'm that hungry. I said, that confident. I said, listen, there's nothing. I'm not even getting paid for this fight. I'm not, but I'm going to beat you. And it was just for the British Masters title, which isn't really a title, but it meant
title was a title.
Title. Yeah. And I had Southern Area already. And I said, no, it was just the principle. I'm beating this guy. He's got a loss of my record. I don't want to lose my record. I know I could beat this guy. Beat him. I didn't, if you look at my start, I didn't beat him by knocking him out. I didn't beat him by being strong. I didn't beat him by being awkward. I mastered the style of being awkward. And I beat him every round. So
what are you going to do now to put your career back on track?
Do you know what? For me, I'm going to have to wait for the opportunity. I might not even get another opportunity. Do you know what I'm saying? But at least I go out with my dignity. Do you know
what you've been there. You should be happy.
Happy.
Your story's like, that sounds like a movie.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to watch the documentary.
I want you to. Please. That's what I was talking about doing a proper autobiography next.
Because what you've been through, for there could be like a young boy out there, girl, whoever, going through the same sort of thing, not knowing that someone has done it. They've come from here and gone to there. So you could be an inspiration, that inspiration that they need. So it's a good thing.
When you see people talking, like, I get a lot of people in and out of the gym, their life's good. Like, everything's good for them. And then you see them in the gym and they just don't put it in. Like, and I think to myself, Olden, you have everything. Like, all we're asking you to do is train. And they just can't do it.
Yeah.
Like, the hunger's not there.
It's not there.
So, yeah. Like I say, with your story, the hunger was there the whole time, and look what you accomplished in that.
Yeah.
So, props to you.
Hats off to you, bruv.
Thank you so much.
Definitely, man.
Going from that, you're at the Mosaic, which is the power of positive thinking, which is the inspires young people who are from deprived communities to realise their talents and potentials. Is that a new project that you're on, or was that just a one-time thing they were trying to help you for?
It was just like a one-time thing, but like I said, I'm always open to do any kind of project that's helping the youth. One thing that is ongoing is that I do a lot of talks in schools. Anytime I get opportunity to go around to a school, I've got a little spiel made up to talk to the kids, which I obviously, you know, talk to them and inspire them. Maybe there's another person just like me. And my message is that you haven't just got to be a boxer. You haven't got to be a fighter. And it's not for everyone. But you need to be a fighter in life and what your profession is. And, you know what I mean? You need to, you know, you can one day be someone.
Your story, I mean, is from, in your words, is it from the tramp to the champ?
Yeah.
That's your story. So that's a good thing from...
Yeah.
Like children out there, or even if they're not in deprived areas, like Dan said, just people who, you know, want a better life or want better things. It's a story, and everyone loves a story that they can get from something or from nothing to something.
Yeah.
So I think it's a good thing.
It's very good. Very good, brother.
Yeah.
D, I know we're short for time. Yeah. Any more questions you got, Miss Lopez?
I just want to know that it seems like everybody in the world has this nickname. Do you have a nickname?
Yeah, the nickname's not really that positive, but...
Can't sell it. It's not a selling point.
It's not a selling point, yeah. But I could always switch it, because I always switch it. The nickname's Ammo. But I could always say that the Ammo, I've got ammunition of lyrics, I've got ammunition of...
Fight.
I've got ammunition of energy, I've got ammunition of inspiration, I've got ammunition of whatever you want to say, anything positive.
The ginger.
The tramp from
ginger. The ammunition of ginger.
The ginger.
Ammunition of ginger coming to you.
The ginger.
Hey, listen, Darren, thanks for coming in,
pleasure,
brother.
Pleasure. Yes, yeah, a pleasure.
Look forward to seeing you again, hearing from you. If people want to get hold of you, let them know if you want them to get hold of you.
Yeah, if you need to get hold of me, I'm on my Facebook. My Facebook name is Darren Ammo Hamilton. Holler at me on there. And that's it, basically. Cool. That's the only really contact at the moment.
Yeah, no, that's cool, man. Yeah. Listen, thanks, viewers, for tuning in to another episode of the Open Match Show. We out.